The names Lennox Oscar Pierre and John LaRose may not resonate with many in Trinidad and Tobago today. After all, Lennox was born in 1919 and passed away in July 1993. John, at 8 years Lennox's junior, was born in 1927. The fact that John had been living and working in London from 1961 means that even though he passed in February 2006, he is not now a household name here. So what about the lives of these two Trinidad and Tobago nationals that makes the naming of this foundation, the Lennox Oscar Pierre and John LaRose Foundation, so significant? In a word, everything. Yes, everything about their lives, their work, and multifaceted contributions to Trinidad and Tobago, and, in the case of John, across the continents, is tremendously important. We want today to bridge that gap so we may come to know who they are, appreciate what they did, and benefit from the foundations that they laid down through selfless contributions which collectively exceeded 100 years. Lennox was born in Port of Spain and lived all his life in our capital city. He went to the Queen's Royal College, and he excelled on and off the field. He wrote poetry, played the violin, and sang in the All Saints Anglican Church Choir. At 18, right after leaving QRC, Lennox became article to his father, who was a prominent black middle-class solicitor. Two of the formative elements of Lennox's life were laid down: the law and artistic expression.
The first one I'm going to do goes back to 1945. Albrecht Cross won the DFC and DSO, and we were quite elated here, and I recorded this. Posterity will learn from many a pen how well our Ulrich matched West Indian pluck and skill with all the pride of England's youth that flew in freedom's name. Its heart will glow at lofty tales of deeds beyond our ken, at novels wrought around his hero's luck. And e'en though poet were mute, the presser's truth from tongue to tongue the ages down will go. But this may not be born, lest someone coins some record for our children's reckoning. How bright and timely do those exploits shine, bracing a people's faith, steeling their spine, against the day all anxious natives sing, against the tasks proud nationhood enjoins.
John was born in Arima. He was Roman Catholic. At the unusually young age of 9, John won a scholarship to attend that other prestigious boys' secondary school in Port of Spain, St. Mary's College, or CIC. John then started working at Colonial Life Insurance Company, CLICO, the first locally owned insurance company founded by a black Trinidadian, Cyril Dupre, in 1936. As a very bright young man, John was part of Dupre's executive team. Nothing so far suggested that the lives of Lennox and John would become intertwined. One common thread was that they challenged the status quo and were never afraid to do so, even having regard to their relatively privileged early life. But we are getting ahead of ourselves. According to one of our comrades, Teddy Belgrave, now sadly passed on to be with Lennox and John, when Lennox became article to his father in 1937, this was the time of the beginnings of the dustbin era of the steel band. Metallic instruments in the form of dustbin covers, old biscuit drums, motor car hubs, etc. were being introduced to the Patambo Bamboo bands. Official society established a special vocabulary to describe the underclasses who engage in these unsavory activities. Cutthroats, vagabonds, were a few of the milder expressions. Lennox chose to be a traitor to his fine middle class roots and play Juve in the Carnival of 1939 with Alexander's Ragtime Band, the Tambo Bamboo Band of Newtown. This would start Lennox's move away from his classical musical background and towards forming an intimate relationship with the artistic expressions of the ordinary people. In the words of Dr. Errol Hill, noted playwright, academic, a close colleague of Lennox in the South, this would start Lennox's move away from his classical musical background and towards forming an intimate relationship with the artistic expressions of the ordinary people. In the words of Dr. Errol Hill, noted playwright, academic, and a close colleague of Lennox in the 1940s,
when did Lennox's transformation occur? When was it that he and others in his circle began to be aware of the richness of our native culture and how significant a role it could play in the march towards political self-government? In August 1940, Beryl McBurney appeared in a dance recital. The program, titled A Trip Through the Tropics, was the first attempt we know of to put folk and creative dances of the West Indies on the concert stage. It was a momentous occasion. It was breaking new ground, and its focus was regional, incorporating Haitian drumming, Venezuelan string music, Trinidad Shango dancing, John Buddy Williams and his orchestra of Calypso fame, and among the vocalists was Edric Connor. Then, in 1943, Connor presented a program that would completely transform Lennox's life. It was called An Evening with West Indian Folk Songs and Dance. Lennox recalled that the limbo dance was the first seen on stage, and that the Gonzales Steel Band also appeared. Also in 1943, police bandmaster Joseph Griffith presented his Griffitharian Evening with the talented Winifred Atwell at the piano. These events were formative influences in the cultural consciousness of the young Lennox Pierre.
Until Edric gave the exposition of the historical development of the Calypso was something there, but and was something that we recognize as local culture. But you didn't see the local culture in its full perspective. To me, the Edric Connor demonstration, it was a sort of, what it was called, an evening of West Indian folk songs and dances. That was by and large the most important performance, cultural performance of the day. That entire period of the early 40s, because 43, I think Griffith gave his musical performance of his own music. Right? Everything at 2 hours.
Something like 2 hours of
program,
his own music.
2 hours. Everything on that program was composed by Griffith. Baritone solo, soprano solo, piano solo, right? Group singing.
And he was also dealing with his situation with being in the force and
yeah, well, for instance, the baritone solo was called God Made Darkies from a Special Mold. Darkies do the cooking, rich man eat the pie, but the day is coming when this fallacy will die.
Yeah.
And what of John LaRose? How did he come to a new cultural consciousness? A young John became active in the literary group, which was organized by notables such as Neville and Undine Giuseppe and Arnold Tomassos. It was in this environment that John was introduced to Marxism. It was also the period when he connected with Calypso. This led him to collaborate with Raymond Quevedo, Attila the Hun, to write the book Kaiso, a Review, subsequently published as Attila's Kaiso. John was now connected to the popular culture and to revolutionary ideas. He recalls this quite vividly.
I was introduced around that time by a friend who's one of the leading Trinidad writers. He was a poet called Giuseppe, Neville Giuseppe. And he said, "Have you read anything by Marx?" And I said, no, I've Marx and communism and so on. I've never heard of, I just know people denigrate these things. And he lent me a book, which was called Lenin. It was about the Russian Revolution.
books were his world. Now, when it came to politics, you wouldn't believe Neville was a rank Marxist and all this sort of thing. Now, I'm not into that. You couldn't believe that a quiet man like Neville, but he knew his politics and so on. So much so that when John started coming around, and then John, shall I say, got into trouble, Neville regretted having, you know, led him astray. John said, not at all, you have opened a world for me.
The second book he introduced me to was C.L.R. James' The History of Negro Revolt. Those two things had a tremendous impact on my life.
How then did Lennox and John meet? No better way to find out than through John speaking.
I had known Lennox Pierre before we became comrades in the revolutionary movement for fundamental change in Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean. Before our meeting, Lennox Pierre was for me a solicitor and who, with Jack Kelshaw, Pearl Nunez Connor, and their friends, had founded the Trinidad Youth Council and then in the 1940s had become involved in the early steel band movement together with an unsung hero of that early movement, Carlisle Kerr. It was the arrest of Carlisle Kerr and later my own arrest at the corner of Piccadilly Street and Paul Street when I was returning home from a private informal meeting of the Workers' Freedom Movement that brought Lennox Pierre and myself and the Workers' Freedom Movement together in action. 10 St. Paul Street was our headquarters and the home of Jim Barrett, a leading member of our movement. The arrest took place during the police commando raids prevalent at the time. The Workers' Freedom Movement and I were determined to confront this abuse of our civil rights. We called on others to join in this effort to protect and defend our rights. This became the beginning of the relationship, both personal and political, between Lennox Pierre and our movement.
Going back to Lennox's path-breaking work, Teddy Belgrave recounts,
"The Trinidad and Tobago Youth Council was formed in July 1944 with Lennox Pierre as secretary. The cultural renaissance of this period, spurred on by the work of Connor and the Youth Council, led to the sound of the ping pong on the radio for the first time in 1947. This was Ellie Mannett playing Brahms' Lullaby on the Youth Council's Sunday evening program. The steel band wars raged during this period. The frown of society turned into an ugly scowl. The police attacked panmen with full force. Spurred on by a hostile colonial press, the ruling elite made panmen an endangered species. The Youth Council decided to act and appointed Lennox Pierre and Carlisle Kerr to intervene, their first responsibility being to keep out the police. Lennox by that time was a practicing solicitor and the warden in residence at the Kokoreet Youth Center. Behind-the-scenes discussions and mediation led eventually to the government-appointed Canon Max Fuqua Committee, which included Pierre and Kerr. Later, in April 1950, organized by Lennox Pierre, Carlisle Kerr, and other officers of the Youth Council, 76 bands came together to form the Trinidad and Tobago Steel Bands Association. The first achievement of this association was to ban competitions for the next 5 years and replace them by steel band recitals. For the recital, Pierre and Kerr went around to establish panyards throughout the country, listening to and selecting bands. Lennox and his violin had become a familiar sight in the invaders' panyard as he sought to teach music to Ellie and others, using his novel method of numbering the notes. Out of this experience came Ellie Mannett's creation of the chromatized ping pong. Lennox Pierre's labor of love bore its sweetest fruit when Trinidad Oil Steel Percussion Orchestra, TASPO, was formed to participate in the Festival of Britain in July 1951. This was the turning point in the musical development of the steel band. The country's top steel bands were invited to send 2 representatives for the formation of this national orchestra under the musical directorship of Lieutenant Joseph Griffith. The TASPO rehearsals took place at the Kokoreet Youth Center. Pierre's work among steel bands and steel bands men did not end here. Many will remember his Song of the Pan Man, one of the first locally composed test pieces for the Steel Bands Music Festival in the early 1960s.
Dr. Errol Hill adds,
Lennox was equally supportive of the Calypso and Calypsonians, whom he befriended and defended whenever that was necessary.
So the friendship between Lennox and John was born out of a common opposition to injustice and their defense of the ordinary men and women in the struggle against the status quo. John provides more details.
Lennox encouraged the Workers' Freedom Movement to join the Youth Council. I became editor and producer of its radio program, and together with Lennox Pierre, we began to move the Youth Council in the direction of support for independence and socialism. We were soon engulfed by the international rivalries of the Cold War. A leading member denounced the new leadership of the Council as communist and subversive, while he participated in the creation of a new national youth movement financed by the U.S.-sponsored World Assembly of Youth and orchestrated locally by the colonial authorities. The Workers' Freedom Movement had emerged in the late 1940s from an alliance between a section of the Marxist study groups and the remnants of the Marxist-oriented Negro Welfare Cultural and Social Association, the NWCSA. This workers' grouping had led the 1937 June 19th general strike and insurrection in North Trinidad. In the person of Lennox Pierre and what remained of the Youth Council, links were being forged with the most revolutionary section of the post-war radical youth movement, which had sought to influence the content of the national culture and steer Caribbean politics in the direction of independence with federation. These were the combined forces that in 1952, together with the radical trade unionists in the Trade Union Council, led by Quinton O'Connor of the Federated Workers' Trade Union and John Rojas of the Oilfield Workers' Trade Union, to form a single political movement, the West Indian Independence Party. I, who had been General Secretary of the WFM, became General Secretary of the WIIP, Lennox Pierre's chairman, and John Rojas' vice chairman. Quinton O'Connor became his treasurer, and Ollie Muhammad of the Old Trinidad Sugar Estates and Factory Workers Trade Union became an executive member. This was the most dangerous ideological political opposition the colonial authorities had encountered since the 1930s. They were determined to crush it. Moreover, we were linked in our Caribbean organizational, ideological, and political perspective with the People's Progressive Party, PPP, led by Chedi Jagan and Janet Jagan. Organized with the participation of the Steel Band movement, this development terrified the British colonial authorities for the same reasons as in Guyana. Plans to derail this movement were made and implemented. Our own view is that without the crushing of this revolutionary movement, the transition to independence under the People's National Movement would not have been possible. The bedrock foundation had to be laid in those two decades, 1932 to 1952, for a movement to put power in the hands of those who, by their labor, produced the wealth that others put in their pockets. This basic movement could only be retarded. It could not be destroyed. After retreating and submerging itself on the political front, it re-emerged on the trade union front with victory through George Weeks and the rebels.
In 1956, the WIIP had fired its last shot. John was the party's lone candidate in the elections of that year. He lost. The PNM began its long control of government. Sometime after the elections, John had to go to Venezuela with his wife Irma, who had family there, as he could find no employment at home. Then in 1961, John went to London. The plan was for him to study law and return home to continue the struggle there. The trajectories of the two comrades would now be different, yet, as we shall see, their relationship remained close. Significantly, both were anchored to the Oilfield Workers' Trade Union and to George Weeks and the rebel movement. John started New Beacon Books as the first black bookshop and publishing house in the UK in 1966 with his partner, Sarah White.
Lennox Oscar Pierre and John LaRose not only dreamed to change the world, but walked the talk as revolutionaries devoting their entire adult lives to that cause.
In doing so, they laid a rock-solid foundation for successive generations to build upon, and a legacy of ideas and actions that few can match.